butterflies, welcome to my garden. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. And now let's get into the video.
Hi everybody, it's your girl Calypso, and I'm back again. And if you're new to my channel, don't forget to like, subscribe, leave a comment, and let me know what you think about the topic that I'm about to dive into, or just let me know where you're from, okay? Now, normally I'll do the I'm back again happy dance, but I don't really feel like it coincides with what I'm about to talk about, because I feel like the conversation that I'm about to have with you all today, or the discussion if you may, I feel like it's a little bit more deep, so it doesn't really fit with the, but yeah, I'm back again. And today I'm going to be discussing the art of self-forgiveness. Now, I find that this topic is not necessarily something that's talked about often. It's not really brought up frequently because for some reason, we all just get caught up in life, and life happens. And sometimes it's hard to just take a moment to reflect and think about what self-forgiveness means. So I feel like I just should touch on this today. I just felt it because a few days ago, I was watching the movie Eat, Pray, Love. One of my favorite movies, and it just came on and I decided to watch that, and it got me thinking about self-forgiveness and how often as women we tend to be hard on ourselves. We tend to be so much harsher with ourselves than we are with everybody else, and it got me thinking and it inspired me to talk about self-forgiveness. So I feel like it's important to fully understand what it means. And first of all, what is forgiveness to begin with? So, forgiveness is defined as a deliberate decision to let go of feelings of anger, resentment, and retribution towards someone who you believe has wronged you. However, you know, most humans, you know, like I said before, most humans, myself included, we're so much more harder on ourselves than we are on others, because we show forgiveness to other people in order to move on. I mean, most people do, I would hope so, because carrying a grudge can often be such a heavy burden to carry through life, because as time goes on, it becomes a personality flaw where you're carrying a grudge constantly from the years that you've lived and the encounters that you've come across. And to carry a grudge from each and every single one of those encounters, whatever they might be, the negative ones, it could affect you mentally. For instance, if you think about the people that you've come across, the ones who are really spiteful and bitter, they're usually the ones who carry the most grudges. You know, when you see somebody who carries a grudge and has a habit of holding on to things from the past, they're usually the ones who are the most hateful, spiteful, and just all around bitter about life, it seems. And I personally don't aspire to be anything like that, so I just decided to use that as an example to explain why forgiveness is important, not necessarily for the person who wronged you, but also for yourself, because life goes on and life is short, and live it, love it, enjoy it, ultimately. So therefore, which brings me to my next point. So what is self-forgiveness, you may ask? So self-forgiveness, this is the act of showing yourself grace and accepting what you've done wrong and letting go of the guilt, the shame, and the regret. Now, this is where growth and evolution from the lessons that you've learned, this is where it takes root, you know? And it's part of the feminine journey, is also taking a journey into self and examining, you know, taking a journey into yourself and almost going down the rabbit hole, kind of like Alice in Wonderland, you know, going down the rabbit hole and examining all the cataclysmic events, the aftermaths, and the dark periods and the transformations that we've been through, and why you're wired the way you are, why I'm wired the way I am. So I had to take that journey into myself and examine all the cataclysmic events, all the dark periods that I've been through, to basically go through a full circle transformation and hopefully come out better than I have before, better than I was before, stronger and more resilient than the person I was before. So that's also part of the feminine journey for me, anyway. The feminine journey, like the story of the feminine journey, that story structure, you know, it's nothing new. It's very different from the heroic structure that we're so used to seeing. You know, the heroic journey is usually a story of man versus nature or man versus the world, you know, and it's very common in literature, it's very common in movies, it's very common in even mythology as well, like the story of Hercules. That's a story of man versus the world pretty much in Greek mythology. And then in film, you have movies like Moby Dick, and then even Pirates of the Caribbean, in a way, it's a heroic journey as well. And then you have the stories of, in literature, the one that I can think of off the top of my head is Robinson Crusoe. Now that's a story of a heroic journey, but this is completely different from the feminine journey, because the feminine journey is not necessarily you versus the world or you versus nature or the elements. It's a journey into self. It's a you versus yourself and facing those dark periods, you know, and facing those structures and all of those events as well. And it's also, the feminine journey is also quite common in movies as well. Like, you know, there's Waiting to Exhale, Eat, Pray, Love, and there's the Eat, Pray, Love movie. You can see her going through a journey of self-discovery, and then she had to come face to face with the choices and mistakes that she had made, and she had to basically confront them and eventually find her happiness and find herself and, you know, come out a better version of who she was compared to the woman who existed before she took on the feminine journey. And then you see the movies like even Wizard of Oz as well, you know, it's a very metaphorical expression of the feminine journey, because here you have Dorothy who goes through what she goes through, and then she ends up defeating the Wicked Witch. So ding dong, the witch is dead, and then she discovers her strength and becomes a better version of who she was. And then in Greek mythology, there's also the story of Persephone, who was abducted by Hades and taken down to the underworld, and she went through a sad period, a period of depression and sadness, and comes up a much better person. And spring, and I don't know, when she comes, it re-emerges as the queen of the underworld, and spring approaches, and the fields are blooming, the plants are growing, and flowers are springing. So flowers have sprung, rather, sorry. So it's, the feminine journey is pretty common. It's a lot more common than we see, than you think, rather. Anyway, so me personally, it's easy for me to relate to the stories of the feminine journey because it speaks to the cycles of my own life as well. My self-forgiveness has kind of factored in by going deeper and almost going into a tailspin, you know? And, you know, I've had to come face to face with I've had to kind of re-examine the decisions that I've made and the mistakes that I've made and how I have reacted to external things that were necessarily not within my control, and how I've handled those dark periods and how I've handled myself. So it's just, and at the moment, you know, we're in lockdown in Sydney, and I've taken this moment as a period of just a self-reflection, and part of that has also involved self-forgiveness as well, you know, because there are a lot of things that I've had to confront just in order for me to be a better version of myself, because ultimately I'm just on that quest to be better and better as the day goes by and, you know, be a fully realized better version of who I am. and aspire to do more and be better and treat people better, you know? So there are several scenarios that it could range from, not necessarily me, but just there are several scenarios, you know? Sometimes you need to forgive yourself for, like, oh, maybe I stayed at that job for too long. The job that I hated, maybe I stayed at that job for too long. Maybe I stayed in that relationship longer than I should have. I shouldn't have gone out with that guy. I shouldn't have dated this person. I shouldn't have gone out on that date, you know? I probably shouldn't have hooked up with this person. So it's just several scenarios that could play in the mind when it comes to re-examining dark periods, you know? All the cataclysmic events and, you know, things that were a trigger and things that sent your life into a whole tailspin and a period of transformation, you know? And as humans, like, most of us are very hard. We're all very hard on ourselves. I know I've said that already, but it's the truth. We're very hard on ourselves. And we're constantly, some of us are constantly seeking perfection. Constantly, almost like an addiction. And however, it helps to remember that, you know, on your quest to achieving goals, you know, the process of achieving goals, it can bring a sense of fulfillment. It could just be something as simple as losing weight or having a goal weight or a goal body size. And achieving goals like that could, it could bring you a sense of fulfillment and a sense of euphoria. However, perfectionism is toxic and detrimental in the long run because you're constantly seeking a high and you find yourself like you're almost like a bottomless pit where you're never satisfied and you're constantly seeking perfection. And over time, it starts to wear heavy on your mental function. So this is where I feel the toxic nature of perfectionism kicks in. And I personally know people like that. You know, I personally know people who are constantly seeking perfection. And when that perfection is not achieved, they become spiteful, they become hateful, they become toxic and unpleasant to be around, you know? I know people like that. I've worked with people like that. So it's pretty common. But that's the shared humanity. But the thing is, I have made it a point to be self-aware of when that toxic trait could rear its ugly head in me, and I'm confronting it and understanding that in the end of the day, I'm still human. I'm still going to fall down and make mistakes. Like, for example, as babies, you know, as human babies, you know, we learn to walk by falling down repeatedly and getting back up again. And I think the same thing should apply to adults as well. Like, we learn and grow from vulnerability, failures, and embarrassment. Now, one of my favorite scenes from Sex and the City is the scene where Carrie Bradshaw falls on the runway and she is so embarrassed. But for a brief second, she's self-reflecting. She is self-reflecting and wondering whether she should just slither off and be humiliated or get back up. This is what I'm talking about. What
fuck me hard. Heidi, go!
Oh my god, she's fashion roadkill!
I had a choice. I could slink off the runway and let my inner model die of shame, or I could pick myself up, flaws and all, and finish. And that's just what I did. Because when real people fall down in life, they get right back up and keep on walking.
So yeah, you can see that. That's one of my favorite scenes from Sex and the City. But it's a learning moment as well, because this is part of human nature. And also, the art of self-forgiveness, it comes full circle when you stop waiting or expecting to be rescued. When you realize that, oh, I have to fix this. I have to handle this for myself. I have to carry out this exercise because nobody's coming to save me. That's when it starts to kick in. That's when it starts to come full cycle. Like when you realize that you're responsible for yourself, you know? And it's not necessarily anybody's responsibility to carry out the exercise until you practice the art of self-forgiveness, it's almost impossible to fully function. So this is what I'm talking about. And then there's also limitations as well to self-forgiveness. Like in cases of suffering abuse, where someone has suffered abuse, someone has suffered a loss, you know, sometimes you blame yourself like, oh, maybe I shouldn't have been in that situation in the first place. Or maybe if I had done this, this wouldn't have happened. But certain things are not within our control, you know, like suffering a loss, it happens. Going through trauma and going through abuse, sometimes you just can't help, but you can't help the cards that you are dealt. But at the same time, you also have to learn to let go and forgive and just release the burden almost and release the beast. Like, accept responsibilities and embrace remorse, and as well as your humanity, you know, coping with your demons and learning how to heal and embracing the lessons that you've learned is also a very valuable ingredient to self-forgiveness. And accepting that things are not necessarily within your control and surrendering to the present is also another key ingredient as well, because when you are able to carry out the art of surrender and enjoying the present and focusing on the present and hoping for the best as you move along is where self-forgiveness kicks in. And ultimately, that's the goal. You know, the mental benefits outweighs everything else, because you find yourself as light as a feather, and ultimately that's the goal of self-forgiveness. And I think it's something that you can practice every day. Even before you go to bed, you can look at yourself in the mirror and be like, you know what, today wasn't exactly a good day and I probably should have done better, but I accept responsibilities for my actions and I forgive myself. Even if you don't believe it, the more you say it, as when you keep saying it, you can train your mind into believing it. I'm no expert, I'm still trying my best. And as time goes on, I've learned to let go of a lot of things. Like, I've made mistakes in my time, you know? I've probably mingled with the wrong people. I've probably stayed in a job for too long that I didn't necessarily like. But, you know, that's life. And I cannot afford to go through life being bitter and being sad, because that's not part of my journey. That's not part of my ministry. I don't subscribe to that ministry. So ultimately, my goal is just to go through life as light as a feather and embrace my feminine journey and hopefully be a stronger, better, more resilient version of myself. And that's my message for today of self-forgiveness. So, what is it that you're holding on to that you haven't forgiven yourself for, and why? And I'll just leave it at that. So thanks for watching me again run my mouth. Hopefully I made sense. Hopefully there were some takeaways for you all. So I'll leave you with that. And protect your energy. Be kind to one another. Spread love and keep the peace. And until then, I'll see you in my next video. So fly high, my butterflies. Bye.